The next item on the order paper is a motion on continuing crisis in hospital waiting times. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. Clerk, please read the motion.
That this Assembly notes the continuing crisis in hospital waiting times, with 376,382 people waiting for a first outpatient appointment, diagnostic test or inpatient treatment as of 31st March 2016. Further notes that whilst there has been some limited improvement over recent months, the situation remains considerably worse than 12 months previously. Expresses deep concern that the number of outpatients waiting longer than the maximum permitted time increased from 15,000 to 100,000, over 500% during the duration of the last Assembly term. Accepts that targets are set in the interests of quality and safety of patient care, and that with every delay there is a risk of ailments progressing and patients coming to harm, and calls on the Minister of Health to detail what action she proposes to take to address this unprecedented crisis.
I call Ms. Joanne Dobson to move the motion.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. Whilst I'm glad we are debating health matters so early within the new Assembly mandate, I take no comfort from the subject. Given the seriousness, this is the second time within 9 months I've brought forward a motion on this issue. And just like the debate my party led last September, the overall intention of today is not to make party political points, nor to apportion blame. Instead, it is to reiterate to the new minister, who I do wish well, with what is undoubtedly the hardest job in this executive, the sheer scale of the crisis affecting our local patients. No one in this Assembly will disagree that there is a crisis engulfing our local health service. The most obvious sign of this, the fact, as the motion states, over 376,000 people were waiting as of the last official publication of waiting times. That's over 20% of our population, over 1 in 5. Whilst I do welcome the slight decrease in the sheer numbers of people waiting over the maximum permitted times over recent months, the improvements are only made following last-minute funding allocations, not through any degree of political leadership or taking control of the wider causes of it. On that point, I would ask the Minister again specifically about the status of the £30 million announced by Simon Hamilton on the 6th of March. Whilst the Executive had previously agreed to allocate £40 million, virtually no record exists of the subsequent allocation. So can the Minister confirm that this money was received and is in the process of being spent? Nevertheless, the overall crisis is unprecedented, far worse than any since the restoration of devolution over 15 years ago. That is even taking the breath away of health experts in other parts of the British Isles. Indeed, whilst I'm not asking the new minister to make comment on this, because it wouldn't be fair as it was before her time, it's worth just remembering the words of Nigel Edwards, the chief executive of the Nuffield Trust, towards the end of last year. He said that heads would roll in England if hospital waiting list figures were on the same scale as those currently seen here in Northern Ireland. This is not a blip, it's not a minor issue, it's the single biggest issue that the Assembly is currently facing. So I was pleased yesterday morning to learn that the Minister decided to make a last-minute statement on this issue. Whether it is related to the timing of today's motion is immaterial, but I was disappointed with the tame tone of it. It certainly, in my opinion, didn't generally recognise the severity of the problem. When asked by my colleague Robbie Butler whether she accepted that delays meant patients were coming to harm, I was surprised to hear the Minister so definitively assert that they are not, that they are all under the protection of their GP. Well, if a GP suspects cancer and refers a patient for an urgent scan, but that scan is badly delayed, Does the Minister still think the patient is being protected from coming to harm? Of course not. A simple example, of course, but one that is heartbreakingly too common at present, and I'm sure that I'm not alone in this chamber in having a considerable number of such cases passing through my constituency office. In addition, yesterday's comments go against what the experts are saying, and in fact what the Minister's own board last year said. So let me quote directly from the 2015-2016 draft commissioning plan. Spiralling waiting times could lead to severely delayed diagnosis of life-threatening illnesses, with suspected bowel cancer patients particularly at risk. And such delays for assessment and treatment are very significant. It is possible that in some cases, increased waiting times for assessment may result in a delayed diagnosis of a serious or life-threatening condition with reduced likelihood of a successful outcome. So perhaps the Minister should reflect in the future before making such conclusive statements. Of course, it's not just cancer patients that avoidable delays are especially detrimental to. The waiting times for cardiology and orthopaedics means there are patients finding themselves in increasingly perilous situations, whilst all the time having to endure the unimaginable pain and distress of waiting. I don't intend to go over how we found ourselves in the situation where our hospitals are clearly teetering above collapse, something the staff working in them regularly tell me, although I will make one comment. The previous Health Minister and those around him tried to build the narrative that the problems in our hospitals were a direct result of the previous debacle on welfare reform. So let me be clear, especially for the benefits of new members, it was not. In the year when our waiting lists really got out of control, the fine for failing to implement welfare reform was £87 million. The overall black hole in the executive's finances was £212 million in that same year. The penalties certainly didn't help the waiting times, but they didn't cause them either. Short-term funding announcements simply don't work, and they especially don't work when trying to run a health service from year to year. Emergency monitoring round allocations only could work for so long before even they proved to be inadequate. All the time, genuine measures such as shifting more care into the community and advancing the broad agenda of TYC all appear to fall by the wayside. It can often be forgotten that the issue of waiting times running into month after month is not just an issue which affects our hospitals. Far from it. Little in the health service can happen in isolation without impacting on another service. As well as heaping worry onto families, increasing waiting times have also been increasing pressures on our GP surgeries. Primary care is a gateway to our health service. However, the continued management of pain and symptoms for those who have been left waiting for a long time for an appointment is heaping further pressure onto an already over-pressurised primary care system. If the patients are feeling the pressure of being left in an endless queue, so too are our health professionals at all levels, and this has been very much in the media today. This is a major challenge for the new minister, and one which I know, if they have not already, the Royal College of GPs will want to have their say. And I know that they have an important message to deliver. Addressing the major challenges facing the entire primary care system will benefit the entire health service. I know from speaking to GPs that they face the daily challenges of repeat prescriptions, increased complexities of patient conditions, and also the effect of the real deep-seated worry which comes with an ill patient being left waiting. That is why we desperately need to move to a sustainable model in order to allow our health service to plan for the future. My party awaits the findings and recommendations of Professor Bengoa and his team. However, I and my party are firm in our belief that decisions about the future of our health service must be made on the grounds of what is best for patient outcomes and well-being, rather than focusing in flexibility on buildings and organisation charts. Too much time has been given to the flawed assumption that if hospital sites close, it would free up endless resources elsewhere. It won't. The savings would be negligible, given that the single biggest cost is medical staff salaries, and the broad consensus is we need more staff, not less. It's the same for the abolition of the health board. Whilst on paper it looks like streamlining, moving staff from one administrative body to another will ultimately do little to improve patient outcomes. We need genuine reforms, not ploys. And I look forward to working proactively with the new minister.
Éireamar, Ms Catherine Sealy. I call Ms Catherine Sealy.
Gura Míle, Principal Deputy Speaker. And can I just begin by thanking the Minister for her attendance here yesterday. I think it's encouraging that this early on she is presenting herself in front of us to deal with these ever-important issues. Can I also take this opportunity to pay a tribute to our frontline staff, many of whom I met out on the canvas trail and who are at their wits' end given the increasing pressures on them in the NHS. I am delighted, though, that in her statement yesterday, the Minister did detail many of the pressures that we are all very aware are existing, including increasing demand, financial constraints, and most importantly, a slowness to bring about radical change and reform to our health service. I concur wholeheartedly with her sentiment that our biggest problem is the way in which we currently deliver services. An overhaul is required, and I look forward to Professor Bengoa's report. I believe partnership will prove crucial, be that partnership with the Education Department here in the North to address pressures on our health service that could have been prevented through increased awareness, or indeed partnership with our counterparts in the South, so as we do share best practice and build upon collaborative service developments. And I would ask the Minister also that she would assure this chamber that, that will happen, and that she would consider possibly the development of a unit within the Health Department, like they do in Scotland, to specifically deal with waiting times. I would also seek assurances from the Minister that she will treat mental health issues and the waiting times within that service with equal concern. I wish the Minister well in her role, and I do look forward to the response in the coming weeks to the current crisis, confident that her intervention, along with the backing of the Executive, will prove fruitful.
I call Mark Durkin.
I rise in support of this motion proposed by Joanne Dobson and to pledge the SDLP's desire and determination to play a constructive role in dealing with what has been and what can only be described as a crisis. I'd like to take this opportunity to wish the new minister well. This is one of many major challenges facing her, but I do also believe there are many huge opportunities that she has as well. I'm not one that usually dwells too much on statistics. All too often the focus is on numbers, and we can lose sight of the fact that each one of these statistics is a person, in this case a person waiting for treatment, a person in pain, a person whose life may be put on hold as they wait for confirmation that they will be seen, they will be treated, and hopefully they will be cured. Today, however, we cannot ignore the statistics. They are totally scandalous. Almost 400,000 people waiting for a first outpatient appointment, diagnostic test or inpatient treatment. That's four times the population of the Derry urban area. This isn't a problem that's developed overnight, and it isn't one that's going to be solved tomorrow. We need to examine the factors impacting on waiting times, and we need to address all of these strategically. There are many contributory causes, and clearly the funding constraints facing the Health Department, indeed all departments, is a major one of these. And these pressures are obviously compounded by the huge and over-increasing demand, a demand that is clearly already outstripping capacity. We should rightly celebrate the fact that people here are living longer, and this is, I suppose, evidence that our healthcare system is working in some way or other, But with that ageing population, with the increase in chronic conditions, more pressure is placed on our hospitals that are bursting at the seams, on our ambulance service, and, as we heard earlier today, on our general practitioners. We can't look at this waiting list issue as a hospital-only problem. All areas of our system are inextricably linked. We must look at what is being spent where and ensure that strategic, long-term planning and investment is forthcoming if this issue is ever to be tackled meaningfully. We all want to see patients get fixed quickly, but we cannot continue with this quick-fix approach of lurching from one monitoring round to another in the hope of getting funding to, in some cases, throw at the private sector or independent sector to pick up the slack. While I, like everyone here, I'm sure, have people close to me who are delighted and relieved when they get a letter telling them that their procedure will be carried out, albeit privately, this system is not sustainable and it is not satisfactory. We should be investing in our health service, not eroding it, and private companies shouldn't profit from people's suffering. Urgent action is needed in the area of staff recruitment and retention, and nowhere is this required more than in the Western Trust area, where last year £13 million was spent on locum doctors. That's almost as much as three other trust areas combined. Transforming Your Care was heralded as the roadmap to a better healthcare, and while at the time of its publication the SDLP did agree with the destination set out in that roadmap, we also emphasised the need to ensure that we had the fuel to get there. As it is, we've barely got out of the forecourt. The implementation of this plan needs investment. Rather than investing to save, the Department seems to have been just cutting to save, and this thus far failure to implement TYC is seeing patients stuck in hospitals due to lack of care packages and essentially bed blocking and exacerbating this waiting list crisis. While much has been made and will be made of the financial cost of tackling extensive waiting lists, what about the costs of not doing so? While waiting so long for treatment, and Ms Dobson touched on this, many people develop further health issues, mental health issues. They can gain weight due to the impact on their everyday activity and ability to do that, and further complications, or the financial implications on those who are out of work as a result of their condition, and those that might have no option but to claim benefits, well, at least to try to claim benefits whilst out of work.
Our next speaker will be Paula Bradshaw, and as this is Paula Bradshaw's first opportunity to speak as a private member, I would remind the House that it is the convention that a maiden speech is made without interruption. I call Paula Bradshaw.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. I feel it is appropriate to make my maiden speech on a subject raised probably more often than any other on the doors, that is waiting lists. There are indeed many cases in the past. As a City Councillor, I worked together with my predecessor, Anna Lowe, to try our best to get that crucial operation or vital diagnosis. Anna, of course, earned a rightful reputation as someone who cared deeply about every case. She recognised naturally that people bringing cases to her were not just numbers on a page. It was that human touch, more than anything, that enabled her to break the mould. Anna was also keen to work across all divides, which is why she was so beloved in South Belfast. She attracted support from every corner of the constituency, and hers are certainly big shoes to fill, not literally, admittedly. I am also proud to know every corner of the constituency, having spent the last two decades working at the grassroots. South Belfast is, in my opinion, the most cosmopolitan part of Northern Ireland. To have this opportunity to represent it and the people in it during this forthcoming period, with exciting developments awaited from Great Victoria Street up to Carrie Duff, is a real privilege. On the subject of waiting lists, at the outset I commend and support the motion and thank the proposers for bringing it to the floor. We should not forget the narrative behind this. Someone waiting for a potential diagnosis for a neurological condition, for example, is left with the worry and concern about this the entire duration of the wait. If that person does have MS, dementia or Parkinson's, to name but a few, They will spend all of that time without vital medication, support or even expert information. Their general health will also most certainly have deteriorated because of the uncertainty. Families and circles of friends are, of course, badly affected too. This is the narrative we are talking about here, not numbers on a page, but real lives lived. It is truly horrifying that anyone would have to wait for a year and a half in such a situation. I think it is worth emphasising that this problem, which is worse here than anywhere else in the UK by any reasonable comparison, is the product of an unreformed health service. We have seen money thrown at the problem in recent months, and yet there has only been slight improvement. Let us be clear, we do not have endless amounts of money to throw at it. Reform is what is necessary. Certainly we need to do all we can to help those on waiting lists now, but we should also be reforming now to make sure no one faces a wait of anything like the length currently being experienced by so many by the end of this decade. On the subject of money, it would be interesting to hear from the Health Minister the details of how much of the money allocated to the problem by her predecessor was in fact spent directly dealing with the waiting lists. Further, I was concerned to hear in her statement yesterday that the Health Minister feels that her ability to tackle this issue seems dependent on successful bids in the June monitoring round. The fact is there will be very few successful bids in the forthcoming monitoring round, a consequence of the previous executive's inability to make the tough financial decisions when even the case was clear. This, of course, speaks to the general failure, which we can predict in advance, of this executive to get serious about general public sector reform, not least tackling and reducing the cost of division. With regard to health, the appalling situation around waiting lists is a direct consequence of inaction on reform. The Minister has her opportunity now to make her mark, and she may rely on us in the Alliance Party to be constructive if she pursues reform in the manner long known to be necessary. She is about to receive a report and recommendations from the expert panel, which will tell her exactly what her predecessor heard from Donaldson, which told him what one of his predecessors had heard from Compton, and so it goes on. We have had enough reviews, reports, commissions and panels. How many of them do we need to tell us the same thing before we embark firmly on the reform process? On these benches, we are not going to oppose for opposition's sake, but we are absolutely opposed to waste, inaction and undue delay. Too many people have waited too long for action on reform to make our health service fit for purpose for the thousands of patients currently waiting for vital treatment. Thank you.
I call Mr. Trevor Clark.
Thank you very much, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. And at the outset, can I apologise for the chairperson of the committee who's actually left the building by this stage, who's actually sick this afternoon, and she was down to speak, but unfortunately, so hopefully she doesn't need an appointment with the GP or the hospital, but however, she has been sick, and I want to record her apology for that. I don't want to underestimate today, the motion that's been down in the name of Joanne Dobson. I think it is crucial, and I think, as even the previous speaker has just said, it is something that's been very topical for many of us on the doors, or indeed, even before we got to the doors, it's been very topical within our constituency offices. I don't think, again, as was said yesterday, I don't think it's an issue that we should politicise, because I don't think it's regardless of your community background or where you come from, it's affecting everyone and every single person within our community. I also don't underestimate, even from the previous speaker, she did refer to some of the challenges in terms of some of those reports, and I think that is valid to say that those reports have been there and things have to be done. But on that, I think it's worth noting that every time one of those reports come, some political parties come at this at an angle that they oppose aspects of whatever those reports may say. So it's encouraging to hear from the previous speaker that it's a case of reform and we need to reform these things. But whenever we reform things, people need to realise that that actually brings about change. And some of those changes is some of those things that most people in this chamber have opposed in previous times whenever other ministers tried to bring about change. So without underestimating the importance of what Ms Dobson has said, and I fully support that and I recognise that in the motion, I think something is required. But I think there is a bit of blue sky thinking in relation to this, and we have to tackle this. And I don't envy the task that the minister has in relation to this. But I think the only way this is going to come about, that if we're all brave, whenever some of those courageous decisions have to be made, that we actually have to support the Minister in doing those, should it be Transform Your Care or some of the other things that have been muted in some of the other reports. I also want to say, I mean, whilst we have to be critical of the health service, we also have to commend those who work within the health service who are working in very challenging and difficult times. And that said, and someone said in some of their contributions today about more staff, I would have been critical, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, about more staff until I met the Chief Executive of the Northern Trust recently, who said that they actually had been out for recruitment campaigns for more staff, but people just weren't applying. Now, that maybe means that the Chief Executive or the Trusts have to look at different ways to try and recruit those individuals, but just to assume that we're not recruiting or they haven't been recruiting is an unfair assumption, given that they actually did go out to competition and people didn't apply. But for me, unfortunately, I have needed the health service a considerable number of times over this last number of years, and one of the things I do see personally as an individual is difficulties with GP appointments, difficulty with Dalrymple DDoc, sending people to A&E, and all these things are adding more and more pressure on the health service. And I think we all have a responsibility to bear, not just as politicians but as members of the public, about how we access it. And are we accessing it in the correct manner? And is every occasion that we use these people as it required? Because I think many times, and I can speak in my own village, in Randallstown, we have an excellent pharmacy, and the pharmacy can treat people with minor ailments. But quite often, we all are familiar, if we go to the A&E department, that we see people who are there, and whenever there has been a crisis, and I've been in the A&E department when there's been a crisis, whenever the staff come out and tell folks, look, we're under severe pressure here tonight, can people go away and come back tomorrow? It just amazes me the number of people can step up, walk out and leave the A&E. And it says to me as an individual that some of those people shouldn't have been there in the first instance. So I have no issue with the motion as worded today. I take encouragement from the Minister's statement to the House yesterday. I took encouragement from the Minister's suggestion that there was a decrease on the waiting times from December to March. I wish the Minister well. I can't offer her any advice because, as the previous speaker has said, there has been various reports. But, as I have said earlier, people have caused problems to previous ministers in relation to the outcomes of those reports and are suggesting different ways of doing things. So I wish the Minister well on this. I think it's something that needs to be tackled. But I think it's not just something for the Minister. I think it's for all the parties to get together and depoliticise the matter of health and actually addressing the particular issue.
I call Dahi Mackay.
I get a pre-vas concur. This, of course, is an important issue, and we in Sinn Féin are more than happy to support the motion. Waiting times for hospital appointments, tests, and admission for inpatient elective care have been a persistent problem with successive health ministers now they have sought to resolve. And I welcome the Minister's statement yesterday in which she described excessive waiting times as completely unacceptable. And I also welcome the announcement that she was actively engaged in seeking additional funding as the first step in beginning to tackle this problem. I don't see how anybody could take issue with that approach. I think the Minister was also right to link excessive waiting lists to the operational ways in which we deliver health services and the need for change. To date, interim solutions have been sought by allocating additional funding to tackle what has been characterised as the backlog. But as well as interim solutions, we need long-term solutions. And I know the Minister has her eye on that longer view. And I'd also be interested in hearing from the Minister what proposals, what solutions she has received from other parties, the opposition parties, about dealing with these waiting times. Because we need more, as the previous member has just said, we need more from MLAs, from parties, than just statements and platitudes here in the chamber. We need action. And we need action from all parties in their offices. We need to see proposals. We need to see that constructive opposition to a solution that is in the best interests of all the people we represent, not just platitudes in front of the cameras. A recent audit report of pre-vas concur put the cost of missed appointments to the health service at more than £11 million a year, and the hospital cancellation rate is significantly higher here than in either Wales or in Scotland, and far too many of those cancellations were actually due to clinicians rather than patients. And indeed, recent research from the health think tank, the King's Fund, identified the importance of whole system analysis and sustained action over time as a way of achieving sustainable reductions in waiting times. And their analysis puts great emphasis on the importance of clinical ownership and involvement as vital in improving outcomes. And of course, as somebody has already said, our staff in the health service, those on the front line, are our greatest asset, and I have every confidence in them working with the Minister to deliver the best possible outcomes for their patients. And this isn't going to be easy in terms of the next 5 years. It is going to be extremely difficult in the context of the cuts to public services that we have faced for the past 5 years, and certainly sometime into the future from the Tory administration in London. And we should never forget that fact, because that is why the health service is facing the difficulties that it faces now, because cuts are coming year on year from London, from an administration that was originally supported by some of the parties in this assembly. So we need short-term investment to deal with the waiting times, but we need a holistic long-term solution, and that requires the backing of politicians here, senior civil servants and indeed clinicians, and it also requires a mature and constructive conversation between all stakeholders. So I would urge parties to follow through on what they're saying here today. So let's see the constructive opposition. Let's see the proposals coming forward, not only in terms of the platitudes here on the floor. Let's see some papers coming from the opposition parties to the Minister so that we can all find a solution to this great difficulty we have with waiting times, to ensure we secure the best outcome for all those that we represent.
Call Mr. Mike Nesbitt.
Mr. Speaker, thank you very much indeed. Happy to rise in support of the motion, and also to commend my colleague and health spokesperson Joanne Dobson for the very constructive approach she has taken in introducing the motion and in pledging to work collaboratively with the Minister on this issue. And may I wish the Minister well in what is perhaps the single most challenging portfolio in the Executive. Certainly, to judge from my own canvass on the doorstep, health issues were number one, and I've yet to meet anybody else who was out canvassing in April and May who felt it was anything other than health that was the most frequently mentioned issue. Number one on the doorstep, regrettably not in terms of the haunt. It was the last department to be picked, and I believe the Ulster Unionist Party is the only party ever to take it as a first choice when Reg MP plumped for health in 2007. But there we go. Mr. Speaker, I would ask the Minister to look holistically at these issues, particularly emergency departments. Previous speakers have talked about questioning why do people end up there. I think it's important that we build our understanding of who sends them there and what their motivations for sending them down that particular pathway are. And of course, we also need to focus not just on people entering the emergency department, but also on how they exit, because there is obviously an issue there with flow. I take the opportunity, Mr. Speaker, to perhaps lobby the Minister on a couple of issues. I have no doubt she will be lobbied, if she has not been already, by the Down Hospital to say that there is a facility in Downpatrick which could do a lot more in terms of outpatient delivery, and that could be one way of easing pressure on waiting lists. And also in terms of using the bed facilities, the ward facilities at the hospital, for people who no longer need to be in an acute bed but are not yet ready to make it all the way back home. So a sort of step-down facility is available in Downpatrick. And it should be no surprise to the Minister that I'm going to take the opportunity to ask her to focus during her term on mental health. We have, Mr. Speaker, quite frankly, perhaps the most appalling per capita rates on planet Earth. It's clearly partly a legacy issue, and there is a triple win there if this executive deals with mental health as it deserves to be dealt with. We will tackle the legacy issue. We will say to people who are trapped in benefits, who do not want to be on benefits, we will help you into a more fulfilling lifestyle. And if we make them economically active, we rebalance the economy. So it is a triple win, and it's high time that it was given the priority and the resources needed. And let me make this pledge to the Minister in terms of resources to tackle waiting times for mental health, I would be happy, and this party would be happy, to support a common approach to London for additional ring-fenced funding on this issue, because it is a legacy issue. And if the Prime Minister is prepared to put £150 million into dealing with the past in terms of truth and justice, surely then the mental health legacy issue is deserving of at least that funding from London. It's not covered by the block grant. There are no Barnett consequentials, so he needn't worry about what he would need to do for Scotland, Wales or any other region of England. And the Labour Party has already committed to the concept that mental health is the one area where Northern Ireland can argue for additional ring-fenced hypothecated funding. And Ivan Lewis, as Secretary of State, made that clear with the publication of his Heenan Anderson report into long-term poverty in Northern Ireland. And I know his successor, Vernon Coker, will support an approach for additional funding for mental health issues within Northern Ireland. I think mental health is an issue, Mr. Speaker, where this executive and this assembly can take positive action which can convince the people of Northern Ireland that it is worth having devolved institutions here on the Stormont Estate. I think people know I feel passionately about it, so passionately that not only have I asked Joanne Dobson to stay as our health spokesperson, but I have asked Robbie Butler, who will wind this debate, to become the Ulster Unionist spokesperson specifically on mental health. And I look forward to hearing from him in a few minutes, when no doubt he will explain why he is so passionate about this issue.
Call Mr. Colin McGrath.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I rise today, hopefully in quieter circumstances, to support this motion because I do care deeply about the health service of Northern Ireland in general and in my own area of South Down in particular. And I do worry about the excessive waiting times and the impact that it is having upon people that must wait. And it would appear, Mr. Speaker, that in some instances the sick are getting sicker as they have to wait excessive times for treatment. And it is therefore timely that this motion is being heard so early in this Assembly mandate. I met, Mr. Speaker, with senior officials from the Department of Health just 2 weeks ago, and I kid you not, in response to my suggestion that the health service isn't working and is failing people, they seemed insulted that I should say such a thing. They told me that the service wasn't broken, that they didn't need any extra money, essentially that all was rosy in the garden. And I think that, Minister, you will have your job cut out convincing senior officials that there is actually a problem, never mind getting them to address it. The issues span the full length of the service, and they include, some of which has been mentioned, long queues at accident and emergency, waiting times for elective operations, excessive waiting times for ambulances, especially in rural communities, inequality whenever it comes to GP appointment waiting times, long waiting times for appointments with consultants, and so on and so on. Our health service, which our own officials, public employees, tell us is in great shape, certainly is in anything but. And we have a cycle of problems in our emergency care. The ambulance takes too long to arrive, then you have to wait in a queue outside our emergency departments. You eventually get inside only to have to wait on a bed, which could be on a trolley, on a corridor, before you eventually get seen by a doctor and then have to wait to get up onto the ward. Then when you want to be discharged, you have to wait until your home care package is in place. And if it isn't, you have to remain in hospital, not for vital and much-needed health care, but merely because there's nobody available to care for you whenever you get back into the community. And the bed blocking issue is prevalent in our community and costing tens of thousands of pounds, but more importantly, it is denying early medical intervention to those that need it. Then at discharge, you have to wait a lifetime to get your medicines, and it can take forever for the ambulance to bring you back home again. So it's not a pretty picture. And even if the health service officials don't accept it, I certainly do. And I don't think that it's a problem of an individual person. We have a cocktail of problems. We have a population that is growing older, and it is presenting more often with more complex needs. Our staff find the other side of the world much more attractive to work in than they do here, and we have the cutbacks to our budget through the Tory cuts agenda, which is implemented by our executive. So the problems are manifold. And I have local problems too in my constituency, Mr Speaker, as has been mentioned. We have the £65 million Down Hospital, built and opened only a few years ago, and yet time and time again the Trust have removed services from that hospital. 24-hour accident and emergency cover was removed. Coronary care has been removed. Most of the unelective surgery is gone, again on and on. The hospital has never really had a chance to get opened. And as an enhanced local hospital, it could be fantastic support as part of a network of hospitals providing specific care and easing the pressures on our level one hospitals. We are from time to time and regularly told that it is the safe delivery of services that counts, not the buildings. And to me, that is civil service speak, for we couldn't be bothered to come up with a more imaginative reason. It's the catch-all excuse that's used for service cuts to our services, and I would say to members that you should beware whenever you actually hear it, because it may not be the actual reason. But I can't help but think that solutions must be found, and as significant contributors, our population, through their taxes and national insurance payments, deserve the well-paid officials at the top to remove their head from the sand and start solving the problems. Now, we do await the results of the review by Professor Bengoa. I was part of that political panel that met him earlier this year, and whilst he didn't say anything that we could disagree with, I hope that he does say something that we will actually sort our problems out and doesn't become just another expensive method of kicking the can down the road. So I support this motion and would like to see resolutions to the problems highlighted quickly in the interests of patients.
Call Mr. Steve Aiken.
Mr. Speaker, I rise in support of the motion from our health spokesman, Joanne Dobson, and also to welcome the Minister all the best in what must be one of the most difficult appointments within Northern Ireland. I only have a few small points. First of all, can we look to comparing our waiting list of 376,000 and 20% of the population? Could we have a statement on how that compares with the rest of the regions of the United Kingdom, particularly Scotland and Wales and the devolved regions in England, where the National Health Service is doing so well? And also, could we also have a look at what's happening in the Republic of Ireland? And that way we'd be able to put some context into these horrendous figures and see where they were. Also in relation to waiting lists and the key role of the Trust, can we have, and I noticed the Minister mentioned it yesterday, can we have early sight on the thinking of the future of the Trust and any restructuring? As she is probably aware, or should be very aware, there is an enormous issue of morale going on within the National Health Service at the moment and between the Trusts, and any comments are likely to add to their uncertainty and again may affect the efficiency of the National Health Service and where we go. And finally, a point...
Would the member agree with me that urgent action is required to reduce the waiting times for patients requiring spinal surgery and referrals, and that even urgent cases are still waiting from October 2015 to see orthopaedic consultants?
I would indeed, and I think anything we should do to be reducing waiting lists and improving the flow of patients through the hospital system should be organised as quickly as possible. But also, can I also ask the Minister to pass on my personal thanks to the staff of Antrim Area Hospital, who, despite ever-increasing waiting lists, reduced resources and the rest, have actually been very successful in improving the health of my constituents, particularly in South Antrim. And it's also a note of personal thanks I would like to pass on to the hospital, because they have been able to help my family very recently. And for that, with particular regards, I would like the Minister to pass on my thanks to the Northern Health Trust and to Antrim Area Hospital as well. But thank you very much indeed.
I call the Minister of Health, Mrs. Michelle O'Neill, to respond. The Minister has up to 15 minutes.
And can I firstly start by welcoming the opportunity to respond to the motion and the comments that have been made so far. Yesterday, obviously, I made a statement to the House where I wanted to talk to the Assembly as my first piece of business in relation to the issue which is waiting lists, which is obviously a priority for me as Minister for Health, and an issue which we need to tackle as quickly as we possibly can. The issue of excessive waiting times is totally unacceptable, and I think that when I listen to members' contributions and yesterday's debate, I think everybody can understand the reasoning as to why we are in the position that we are, insofar as we can identify with the fact that there's been an increase in demand for services, that that we need to address those challenges by investing a lot more in preventing illness and promoting healthy lifestyles. And that's going to require a much needed focus on reducing health inequality so that no matter where you live, that you have the same chance of a long and healthy life. We have to promote healthy lifestyles further to avoid pressure on services. And furthermore, we need new developments in medical technologies and drugs are also increasing demand on raising costs. So that means that we must use the limited resources that we have and we must use them in a wise manner. I welcome the tone of the debate so far, insofar as people are suggesting that they want to work with me constructively in order to tackle this major issue, and I hope that that will be the case. I am open to listen to suggestions from people. I did listen to some commentary today in relation to the short-term issues and that it's not good enough just to throw money and monitoring rounds at the issue. We have to deal with the immediate issue, and the immediate issue is actually getting patients seen. So in order for me to be able to do that, then I won't be apologetic for bidding in to the monitoring process to actually achieve additional funding. And the fact that the executive did put additional funding towards the Department of Health towards the end of the last year meant that 80,000 patients did actually receive treatment. So that, for me, is something that we shouldn't shy away from. It's something that I'll not be apologetic for in bidding in for additional funding, because I have to deal with the here and now. But I certainly have a vision for the health service. And my vision for the health service would mean we shift the focus from acute care and move to the point where we're able to invest heavily in preventative measures, tackling root causes about why people get sick in the first place. Catherine Seeley actually pointed to the fact that, you know, I need to work more with other departments, and I'm certainly up for that, because I do think that there are many, many challenges in relation to poverty, isolation, all those things that we need to tackle, and I want to tackle those constructively with other departments. Because only then, if we are able to tackle those things and stop people from actually needing and depending on the health service further down the line, are we going to actually make a difference? Because we're continually going to have this conversation around waiting lists and challenges in the health service, of which there are many. I am 2 weeks in post, and I have certainly identified many, many areas where we need to reform and make things better and reconfigure services. So when I look to the future, I look towards what can we do in the short term? And that's about trying to deal with the massive and unacceptable lists that there are there. But when I look to the future, I think we have to look at where we want to be and how do I get my or chart my way forward. I really look forward to Professor Bengoa's report, because I do think that is going to be key. There has been quite a number of reports, and I absolutely agree with that. So let's now use Professor Bengoa as a step forward. I certainly am going to use that to develop my vision, and I'll put that vision to this Assembly, and I hope that all parties can actually support that vision, because I don't think that we're all speaking with forked tongue here. I do believe that actually people are genuinely interested in actually trying to work together and deal with the many challenges in the health service. So if anybody has ideas, I want you to come forward and talk to me about that. I'm a minister who's open to discussing those issues. I think that if you let me just get through a wee bit, then I'll let you certainly come in towards the end. I think, as I said, the way we deliver services, it has to be transformed, and I intend to focus my efforts on making that transformation. But I listened today to some of the contributions from members, and members, and we'd all be guilty of it, we'll all look after our own constituency and you'll all talk about the services in your area. It's not about buildings, it's about how we provide services to people. I much prefer to offer to people the best possible service that we can offer, and I think that's where we need to focus our attention. So I want to focus my efforts on reshaping our health and social care sector to make sure that we're as effective as we can be. And there must be a firmer grip on the strategic direction of healthcare delivery in the North to ensure that the best possible healthcare for all our patients. As I said yesterday, the work of Professor Bengoa is critical, and I believe that when he comes next week, I'll be speaking to him, but I think he's also offering to speak to all parties, and I know other parties have taken that opportunity in the past, and I encourage you to do so. Again, he's going to hopefully produce his final report towards the end of June, and I'd be keen to come back to talk to the Assembly about how we move forward with that. I think that there's also areas for strong cooperation with my colleagues in the South. I think that we need to build a strong partnership. We've seen where All Ireland working in the past has been able to deliver for healthcare services, particularly in relation to the children's service and Dublin and Belfast. And I think that we need to build a lot more on that and find efficiencies where we can, and working together to make sure we provide a first-class health service for all the people on this island. I think that when we... I'm going to give way. I said I'll give way to Joanne Dobson first, so I'll let you in towards the end. I think that we're all going to have to rise to the challenge and make the changes that are necessary to ensure that we get a health service that continues to deliver for those in greatest need. And the message is very simple. We can't stand still, and we must evolve to survive. So I want to recognise, like others, the hard work, the professionalism and the skill of those staff in the health and social care sector. And I'm going to engage with frontline staff from day one. I said I would do it from day one, and I'm glad to have been out on the ground and meeting with staff. And I think that they are the best people who are best placed to tell us about the challenges that they encounter every day as they go about trying to look after people and give them the best possible care. So I very much look forward to continuing to work with the staff in terms of charting our way forward, because whilst I have a vision and I want to get political leadership and have all the other parties signed up to that vision, I think that we clearly need to have our healthcare workers and our staff actually signed up to that vision and them believing in it, because they're the people that are providing the service. So that's going to be my job of work over the time ahead. As I said, members referred to the fact that, you know, that this is not a blip. It's certainly not a blip. I think we can see that. But I also referred to the fact that June monitoring isn't the solution. But it is the solution, as I said, in the short term. And we have been able to reach 80,000 patients have benefited as a result of that. And I will look, and I will be, over the next number of weeks, in discussions in relation to June monitoring, also making further bids that allows me to do that. Because of the recent investment, those waiting for their first outpatient appointment, the greatest reduction has been in those waiting more than 52 weeks, which has been down by just under 25% since December, and those over 18 weeks down by 18%, and those over 9 weeks down by just under 18%. So that's to be commended, but there's a lot more to do and a lot more to go. So I think that when we look to the future, I think personally this investment is not enough in itself. Money isn't just the issue. Money will help us be able to get some people seen immediately, but it's certainly not just the issue in the longer term. I want to be investing in transforming the health service. I want to be investing in health inequalities. I want to be working with other departments to be able to head off the issues before they become acute issues. So I think for me, when I look to the future, I'm going to look and I'm going to continue to hold trust to account. I'm going to continue to work with the Health and Social Care Board. You'll remember from yesterday I pointed out the fact that the Board have been tasked with creating the 5-year plan in relation to elective care. I intend to make sure that I fully take control of that and make sure that I lead in terms of being able to hold trust to account around the work that they're doing and making sure that they are doing everything possibly that they can in relation to elective care. So, in finishing, I suppose I fully understand why the motion has been brought to the House today, for the same reason as I chose to make a statement yesterday to the House. The current situation in respect of waiting lists isn't acceptable to me. Waiting lists are still far too long, but it's very clear that the recent investments directed towards waiting lists are making a difference, and that will take time and significant non-recurrent and recurrent investment to bring waiting lists back to an acceptable level, whilst at the same time simultaneously trying to increase the capacity to meet demand. And the reality is that we don't have the capacity in the health service at this moment in time to be able to deliver for people, in the manner in which we wish to. So I want to get to the point where we're not using the private healthcare sector, because I believe that's money that we could be investing in increasing the capacity within the health service. Whenever we look towards having a health service that's free at the point of delivery, free for all, then I think that we need to be seriously addressing the root causes as to why people get sick. And only whenever we get to that stage, I think, will we truly have a health service that's on a sustainable footing. But I'll give away to Joanne Dobson very quickly towards the end.
I thank the Minister for giving away. I want to raise a point I raised yesterday, I raised again with my speech, and I raise again for the third time, specifically, Minister, about the status of the £30 million announced by Simon Hamilton on the 6th of March. Whilst the executive had previously agreed to allocate £40 million, virtually no record exists of the subsequent allocation. So can the Minister confirm that this money was received and is in the process of being spent?
As I pointed out in my statement to the Assembly yesterday, tackling excessive waiting times is obviously high on my agenda for improvements. And in relation to the £30 million, the additional £30 million that was committed by my predecessor was obviously an important step in allowing us to be able to reach those 80,000 people, which I've already referred to. That's going to support up to 25,000 additional assessments, some 12,000 additional treatments across a wide range of specialities, including orthopaedics, gastroenterology, neurology and ENT. Importantly, it's going to see £10 million investment in diagnostic services, building capacity to support up to 50,000 additional tests to help meet increasing demands, as well as supporting 7-day services. Trusts have also been asked to put in place arrangements to continue to undertake additional in-house activity during the first quarter of 16-17. But again, I'm back to the point, on its own, this investment isn't enough. This money is money that allows us to actually get treatment to those people as early as we possibly can, but it's not enough. It's not simply a money issue. I'm asking for this Assembly to support me to transform the health service, and I'd ask them to be constructive, because I listened, as I said, to the contributions of the debate, and by and large they were constructive. Sometimes a bit of political point scoring slips in, but I'd ask people to try and rise above that, to help me to help people, to help me to transform the health service, because that's certainly the job that I'm committed to in the time ahead. Gurmila Maugav.
Before I call Mr. Robbie Butler to conclude and wind up on the debate, for which he has 10 minutes, this is Mr. Butler's first opportunity to speak as a private member. Therefore, the normal convention of the House will apply that a private member's maiden speech is not interrupted. That is, if you do not make remarks which are deemed to be very controversial, when you may in fact lose the protection of the House on that. Call Mr. Butler.
Here. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And just before I begin my maiden speech, I would just like to make the House aware of some just breaking news of a man and two children who have been struck by lightning in Lisburn and taken to hospital. So I'm sure as a group we would wish them well in their recovery. Mr. Speaker, I look forward to the day when I don't have a piece of paper in my hand to deliver a speech in this House, but you'll forgive me for my nerves. It's a privilege to address you all in this House as an MLA. I also think it is important that the first topic I'm speaking on is the greatest challenge facing the executive at the present. That is the very serious crisis in our local health service. As a former councillor in the Lisburn and Castlereagh City Council, I acknowledge that I have limited knowledge of the procedures of this House. However, I have spent over 20 years as an employee and a manager within public service. Training and experience in this capacity has taught me that working together for the common good can only be achieved by recognising respect for all. And as a Christian, I believe that there's no place for hatred or bitterness to those who would express opposing views. And indeed, I would suggest that angry and aggressive positions adopted in this regard suggest an inability to defend their position and an attempt to appeal to an audience. Mr. Speaker, I am here to represent all the people of Lagan Valley. I was born in Lagan Valley and continue to live there, and I will give of my best to do so. I am a very proud member of the Ulster Unionist Party, which has a rich heritage in Lagan Valley, and the party enjoyed a return to form there with myself and my running mate Jenny Palmer enjoying electoral assurance from the voters. I would like to thank the electorate of Lagan Valley for their unequivocal support and their vote of confidence, and I would like to put on record my commitment to the role of scrutinising and holding the executive to account for their actions, inactions and their performance in this mandate. Our collective duty is to work tirelessly, represent the concerns of the community and remember that we work for them, not for ourselves. Northern Ireland is a country that we should all be proud of. We could remember that there 42 United States presidents had their roots in Ulster. We have produced leaders in sport in the fields of golf, rugby and boxing, to name but a few. And as has been mentioned earlier, the national football team is currently preparing for the Euros in France. And I wish them great success. So if we consider the achievement of our country's football team, then perhaps we as a House can draw on their process for working together to make this country great again. And health is an issue which I really do hope we can all agree is far too important to simply get caught up in political wrangling. The 376,000 people referenced in today's motion deserve better. I was delighted and honoured to be given the role of spokesperson for mental health for the Ulster Unionist Party. My party recently produced a policy paper on mental health, and no one can deny the shameful statistics that have been published regarding this country's atrocious rates of suffering due to poor mental health and well-being, a legacy of the troubles, terrorism and associated criminality that contribute heavily in this regard, coupled with poor government strategy and direction, leading to social inequalities and social deprivation that blights our society. And there are problems with our waiting times that do not simply apply to just physical ailments. For instance, regionally, at the end of March 2016, the number of patients waiting longer than 9 weeks to access adult mental health services had increased compared to the position at the end of March 2015. At the end of March 2016, 338 patients were waiting longer than 9 weeks, which was an increase of 201 compared to the previous year. My various roles whilst working in the Fire and Rescue Service taught me that though intervention is a vital component to ease the suffering and to save the lives of those affected by trauma, the most effective strategy must and has to be prevention. And it is to this end that I would like to see a process developed that delivers an infant mental health framework that identifies and addresses issues at children's earliest stages, coupled with a compulsory educational element for school children that looks at social and emotional learning, which will complement the development of our children into healthier and happier adults. I give my personal and party commitment to raise the profile of mental health and wellbeing with the Minister and the Health Department, to seek parity of funding that will ensure that those who suffer are afforded the care required to help them live their lives to their full potential. Timely access to professional medical assistance is fact and cannot be a point for debate for this House, and sadly my own constituency of Lagan Valley has suffered over the last two mandates with the removal of the 24 accident and emergency facility to be replaced by almost office hour access. Patients are unarguably put at greater risk through lengthy waiting times that contribute to poor health and increased recovery times. Sadly, earlier this year, in Lagan Valley alone, there were 2,944 people waiting longer than 18 weeks for their first consultant-led appointment. That is 2,944 people whose physical and mental health suffer, not due to their own actions, but because they cannot gain access to a specialist or a consultant within the prescribed 18-week timeframe. Mr. Speaker, I look forward to working with my party colleague Joanne Dobson and indeed all members of the Health Committee, who I know share a common vision to see a healthier community with a greater sense of wellbeing for others. And if I could just then wind the motion. I listened attentively to what was being said, and it was probably one of the best sessions that I've sat in, because I do believe that there may indeed be a collective will in this House to see increased health and wellbeing for all the people of this community. My colleague Joanne Dobson did indeed open the debate with her motion, and she pointed out a number of statistics which have been well documented. The most startling of those, perhaps, that over 20% of the population are on those extended waiting lists, and I don't think there was a member here which disagreed with that. However, she was disappointed with the Minister's response to my question yesterday. Joanne pointed out that there are increased pressures on carers, professionals and the healthcare system, and called for genuine reform. Catherine Seeley praised the Minister and frontline staff, also called for an overhaul of the health service and welcomed Professor Bengoa's report. She also looked forward to possible cross-departmental strategies, which I like the sound of, given my call for education as an essential component. Mark Durkin rose in support of the motion and stated that the statistics cannot be ignored because they're not statistics. We're talking about people. Also, that these statistics were scandalous and that demand was fast outstripping capacity. Investment, not profit, was the way forward. That's how Mr. Durkin ended. Paula Bradshaw gave her maiden speech, and I congratulate her on that. You didn't seem to have the nerves that I have, Paula. Paying tribute to Anna Lowe, the former MLA for South Belfast, commended and supported the motion also, and added about the psychological burden of the lengthy wait that people were forced to endure. Trevor Clark then spoke and called it a topical issue, and it was topical on the doorsteps through the canvas, and reminded us that reform requires change, which I think we would all have accepted. Trevor had no issue with the motion and encouraged the Minister by saying that he looked forward to working with her and that hoping that health would be depoliticised. My leader, Mike Nesbitt, then spoke and said that the number one issue has to be health. And that was the number one issue on the doorsteps pre-election. Regrettably, it was the last department to be selected in the De Hunt process which we all noted, and it was very disappointing, given that it was the number one electorate issue. Also, I was glad to note that he did raise the profile of mental health, and I have already stated that I'm very privileged and proud to take that mantle, and I hope that the other members will take on board the importance of mental health and where we need to put it within
the Health Committee.
Yes, okay. And I can't really talk about the Minister because I haven't got much time to wind up, but I thank the Minister and I do look forward to working with her in the future. Thank you, Speaker.
Well done, Robbie.
The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it.